So you've been rather busy. You've kind of like, it feels like this year you've kind of gone in all kinds of directions between Midnight Special and Loving. It's like...
Yeah. The funny thing is, you know, I had a really relaxing summer. Because I was burned out. Mm-hmm. Basically, after the process of making Midnight Special, then going into making Loving, two very different, you know, processes, but, and then releasing Midnight Special and then taking Loving to Cannes. By summer, I was ready for a break, but I got one, and now we're kind of gearing back up. So I actually feel pretty well rested.
So the Midnight Special experience.
Yeah.
Beloved by critics, not seen by human beings as a rule.
No, apparently not.
A studio movie, which is kind of a surprise, I think, on every side of it.
Yeah.
Was that a different kind of experience, or was it just the budget's a little bit bigger?
Which part?
Making, just the process of making the movie, the process of doing the movie.
No, it wasn't too different, but that's because of the way it came together. To call it a studio film is an odd thing. The studio financed it, you know, and they were there for the whole process. But, you know, I went to Warner Brothers with the script and said, this is what I'd like to do. Would you like to do it with me? And they said yes. So, you know,
was that a nervous thing? I mean, was that like, did you have assumptions about what it would be like being?
No, not really, because at the beginning, we were given a path to production. There was a green light, you know, on the script. So it wasn't a development process at all. It was like, no, we want to make your movie. Now, of course, the trick that happened there was Jeff Robinov, who greenlit the film, then left the studio, and Greg Silverman took over. And, you know, that was a little nerve-wracking, but it turned out okay, you know, in terms of the process of making it.
I'm going to take a break for 1 second.
Yeah.
I just realized I didn't make sure you were focused.
Oh, sure.
Again, a problem with DIY, what it's doing today.
That's fine.
Sorry. I don't want you to be out of focus.
Sometimes it's a benefit.
So you went through a regime change.
Went through a regime change, which, you know, is like that kind of thing you always read about in books about the studio system and everything else, and we lived through it.
Did you need a big studio to make the film? I mean, financial, was it the cost of the film that required a bigger machine, or was it?
To a degree, I mean, you know, I think, gosh, without tax incentives, you know, we spent just shy of $20 million.
That could have been gone,
maybe. I don't know, you know. I don't know. I know they have pretty strict budget caps and stuff, but they break those for certain people. But I don't know. Warner Brothers was the only place I took it to, and they said yes. And who doesn't, you know, who doesn't want that answer? But I think, you know, the studio we went into and the studio we came out of were two different places, admitted by them, you know. Certainly that had some impact, I think, on the film, but at the end of the day, I made the movie I wanted to make. So, you know, I need to take credit and responsibility for how it does out in the world.
Yeah. Well, getting it out of the world is another animal altogether.
It is.
And I think Warner Brothers actually is one of the great studios releasing certain kinds of movies. But like any studio that is, you know, releases giant movies, they have a hard time with something that's a little more delicate.
Well, yeah, and it's a strange movie. I love it. I'm very proud of it. It's honestly one of the most personal films that I've made. Personal to my life and my own kind of story. It's just, you know, I don't know. You can make arguments for how it was released and other things. I think. At the end of the day, when I turned it in, it wasn't a clear awards contender for them. And that kind of was befuddling, you know. They said, well, all right, where do we stick it? What do we do with it? You're supposed to be the awards filmmaker. It was never enunciated that way to me, but that's kind of how it felt. Like, what do we do with a non-awards film? And they released it in the spring. And, you know, that... they were really cautious about it. Jeff Goldstein over there said to me repeatedly, you know, this isn't a film you get caught speeding with. You know, you want to slowly release it, and it just didn't take, you know. I'm bummed out about that.
Yeah. So conversely, when a picture it's funny because the indie world's numbers and the studio world's numbers are very different. But
sure,
when something like Mud happens, is that a celebratory? It's not the word. I'm not
celebratory.
Word. Celebratory. Thank you. Moment, is that like terribly exciting that it has caught on and has become this kind of phenomenon in that context?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, I felt it. I felt it in the moment, and I was also, you know, in the process of getting Midnight Special, you know, presented to the studio and everything else, and that was happening in a relative time and space, mm-hmm. and those two things impact one another. You know, people just—it's on people's lips, it's on people's minds in the industry, and I think that helped Midnight Special get made. In fact, I know, you know, when I spoke to Robinov about it, he was like, "I think Mud's amazing," and so that opened the door for that.
And did your experience at Cannes, I don't know if this, because there are all kinds of variations in the story, but there was a sense at Cannes that it was not terribly well received by the distributors that were there,
Mud.
The buyers. Yeah.
No, nobody wanted it. Not terribly well, just terribly. Yeah, it went really poorly. We went several months without anyone, you know, stepping up to release the film. And luckily, Roadside Attractions did. They worked with Everest, who was our financing company, and were able to come up with a P&A expenditure that made sense for everybody. And the smartest thing I think they did was they released the film. You know, we opened on 650 screens. Midnight Special never got above 520, something like that. You know, it's hard because having grown up in Arkansas, I live in Texas, I have a very different opinion about the way the middle of the country views movies, you know? And I'm just of the opinion that if you're on the Today Show talking about a movie, your movie should be in theaters across the country so people can watch it. You know, but Focus is releasing Loving this way as well. But that's a much more traditional release strategy for this type of film. Like, the audiences have been conditioned to accept a platform release in the fall, mm-hmm. more than in the spring, I think.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
And they have a long-term, you know, a long-view awards plan for it as well.
Of course, it's a completely different strategy. But just to say, well, this is a smaller film, so it needs a platform release, I don't know. It bothers me a little bit.
Well, I mean,
but I trusted yeah. Warner Brothers in that approach.
The spend and the width, the breadth of the release often has to do with just the spend they're going to make. So
yeah,
it's all very
contingent. Mud clicked, you know. Mud clicked for a lot of reasons.
Yeah. Did you know Mud was going to click? Were you? I mean, you knew what you had.
I don't know if I ever think about that stuff. You know, which is maybe certainly naive. But that was also only my third film. You know, when you make Shotgun Stories and Take Shelter, you're just hoping somebody sees them. With Mud, I knew I had famous people in them, but McConaughey wasn't in the same place when Mud was coming out of Cannes as he was, you know, later.
Right.
So all of that turned into this kind of wonderful cocktail. Plus, I think the movie was good, and that helped. And people seemed to really enjoy it. But no, I don't know. It's not that I ever sat down and calculated, I think this movie could make this much money, but I definitely thought, like, well, I think this is a movie a lot of people can identify with. You know, I think this is a lot of, there's a lot in here that people would like, this type of film. You know, I told a couple people, it's kind of like, you know, you're making Stand By Me. I think there's room out there for a film like that.
Yeah. In a weird way, I must think the critics that love the movie overplayed it to the point where it actually hurt them a little bit.
Mud,
because
Midnight Special.
Midnight Special, because it became like an art house movie in the minds of, the way they described it was so kind of intimate and intricate.
Right, right.
That the idea that it was just entertaining, which
right.
it is, it's a very entertaining movie.
Thank you.
Was not, like, that wasn't on the plate. It was like, you know, it's deep, it's meaningful, it's like going to change your life, which is hard.
Yeah, I don't know, you know. I don't know. I think if I could look at a calculated error, it might be, and I'm at fault for this as much as the poster or anything else, but, you know, attaching it to its inspirations so much. You know, obviously Close Encounters was a big inspiration for me, and talking so openly about that, as well as Starman. People went possibly expecting that experience. And just because Close Encounters inspired it, it doesn't mean that's the experience you're going to get out of it. It's a different movie. It's one of my films. It's not a Spielberg film, you know? And if you're looking to get that experience, you might be disappointed.
Well, the irony is to have Stranger Things now come out and
I know,
have
I haven't similar watched it
themes.
Yet. I haven't watched it yet. I'm going to. Everybody says it's amazing. And I just, honestly, just kind of hurt my feelings a little bit. And but I'm gearing up. I'm going to sit down. I'm going to watch it. It's going to be amazing. I know.
So do you mind being a beloved culty director? I mean, like the people who saw Shotgun Stories, which was a relatively small number of people, but very intense love with that movie. Really the same thing with all of your movies. I mean, Mud was the commercial one within the indie realm, but people love you and your work, but you haven't had that financial breakout, I guess, as it were.
Yeah, not beyond Mud. I don't know. I don't mind it. I'd rather be in this position than, you know, nobody caring. So I'll take what I can get, I suppose. But also, yeah, I mean, I'm a competitive person. I want to make a film that makes a bunch of money, because a bunch of money means your film has kind of touched the zeitgeist, you know, to a degree. It means people are talking about it, people are watching it, and I don't want to be obscure. No, that's not a goal. I genuinely don't. But at the same time, having made five films now, I'm starting to maybe see not the limitations of my own aesthetic, but just understand it a little bit more. This is kind of how I make movies, you know? And they're kind of weird. And they're focused more on character and emotion than they are on plot. And that's not always easy for people to receive as an audience. And as much as you think as a storyteller and a filmmaker, you're malleable and you can step outside of, you know, your own limitations or anything else, I think I'm starting to realize, no, this is kind of who I am as a storyteller, and that's okay. That's okay, but I'm still intrigued by the idea of applying that to maybe a bigger idea.
So where did Loving come from for you?
It came from a call that I got really through my agent, which is such a gross way to talk about it, but it's true. They sent me the documentary, and he said, the producers want to talk to you about making this into a narrative film. And I was just immediately struck by it on a couple of levels. You know, I was ashamed that I didn't know the story. I grew up in Arkansas. I went to Little Rock Central High, which was the site of the desegregation crisis in 57. I was pretty steeped in civil rights history, as much as a, you know, kid born in 1978 could be. Mm-hmm. And I felt like I knew about things and was kind of up to speed, and to not know about this, especially in a time in 2012 when they were approaching me, when marriage equality was such a massive issue, for this not to be on lots of people's lips seemed like a shame and seemed like something we could possibly correct. But then beyond that, as a story and as characters, I really felt connected to these people. They're beautiful people. They're very simple people, and they're very attached to a place that I'm familiar with, which is the South and the American South. And so there was a lot to get on board with, I guess.
And then you just started working on the script, or?
Yeah, the first thing I did was I took a trip to Virginia, and I met Peggy Loving, the only surviving child of the Lovings. I saw the courthouse where they were tried, which is what we used in the film, the jail where she was held, which the exterior we used in the film. I saw the home that he built for her. I saw these kind of this rolling farmland, which is really gorgeous. And I just tried to take in the place as much as I could and talk to as many people as I could. And then I dug in, and Nancy, who made the documentary for HBO, sent me a hard drive with all of the outtakes of every interview she did, because there were a lot of people that I approached that didn't want to talk to me just because they had just talked to Nancy for the documentary. And that's fine. You know, they were kind of like, I've said, you know, I just did this. And that's a fine response. And I luckily had all of their outtakes, you know, from their interviews. Mm-hmm. And I just pored over it. But it was a weird thing because there's so much written about the court case. That's what everybody writes about because that makes sense. That's what history does, right. You know, and there's a lot of detail to draw from that. There wasn't much about the day-to-day existence of the Lovings. There were a few key details, and I started to lay those out into a narrative structure.
And it just came together quickly? Was it hard? Was it a tough write?
There was about a two-month period where I was kind of paralyzed just by knowing these were real people and having to move them around on the page and not being 100% certain that they said this. There are a lot of lines that are taken, you know, directly out of the documentary. Right. So those are easy scenes to write because you're like, well, they said it. You know, I can feel confident about that. But obviously at some point you have to just take a step and a leap and say, I don't know if they said this. I don't know if this happened, but it feels like it could have happened. It feels like it's in keeping with what I know about them and the nature that I've been able to kind of draw out of watching them and all of this archival footage. But yeah, I was paralyzed for about 2 months. And then finally I just got over it. I had to.
Yeah.
One, because there was a deadline and the producers were waiting on the script. So I just started writing. And I wrote it.
Was there any kind of backstop for you to say, would, you know, to get the daughter's approval or to get the, or to be positive or encourage you or any of that?
Not so much. You know, that was coming. That would come once the script was finished. And that did happen once the script was finished, which was a massive relief. But I was pretty alone in the process. I had Phyllis Newbeck's book, you know, Virginia Hasn't Always Been for Lovers. I had Nancy's documentary, and then I had all of the archival footage. And it's just every day I would just look at it and listen to it and try and get into the rhythm that was Richard and Mildred. And really just, it was really about the narrative structure. And that's what's so odd about the film. You know, there is no traditional climax in the film. Mm-hmm. There's an emotional climax, and there's the climax of the court case, which is happening though off screen, essentially. Mm-hmm. So it's a really odd narrative structure, but it's one that I was intrigued by. I'd always wanted to tell a story in seasons. Mm-hmm. So you have a decade of time, basically 10 years-ish, and I wanted to see that not evolve through chyrons on the bottom of the screen, but just through, it should just slip by. Mm-hmm. Because that's part of the pain of the story. They're just losing time. And all of a sudden it's winter again, and then it's summer again, and then it's winter again. And that to me is almost as painful. And it's just something that happens in the background of the film, but it was really important to us. It was important to the way we shot the film, but also the way I wrote it. So I wasn't thinking structurally in a traditional sense, but I never do. You know, three-act structure and I don't see eye to eye all the time, which I paid the consequences for that relationship too. But
do you feel like you paid the consequences, or do you feel like you've reaped the rewards? I mean,
both.
It works both ways, yeah.
It works both ways, you know. But I do think there's a way that audiences are used to receiving a story that is somewhat counter to the way I lay things out. But I also think with Loving, that's paying off. You know, for the most part.
One of the things that's very striking about it is how simple they are, particularly him,
mm-hmm.
And you know, non-traditional in that way as well. I mean, it's not
a hero in the
traditional movie heroes.
Sense.
Yeah,
and that was a real trick for Joel and I. And I think part of the reason why I'm so proud of his performance, it was a constant equation of, well, what does Richard understand in this moment? Because Mildred had more of an education than he did. So how much is he actually understanding in this moment versus how much is he just frustrated and unable to express? Because that was another limitation of his inability to express his feelings, his thoughts. That just wasn't his strong suit, you know? And so we were constantly trying to say, okay, where are you at on that scale? Because if we just make you completely confused in this moment, then we're going to be in danger of separating you from the audience. How does an audience identify with someone that they understand something and that character doesn't?
You don't want to make them money.
Exactly. Like, yeah. Like he's got to understand the heart of things, which is what Richard really does. And that line, "Tell the judge I love my wife," is a beautiful reduction of the whole problem and the whole issue. And that's what Richard, that's kind of the space he lived in. So you know, that was our, I think that was our big challenge for Joel and mm-hmm. and Richard. Mildred's a different character entirely. Mildred is the active character, which is a, you know, even she's very quiet, but she's the one that you see begin as this 19-year-old girl and really evolve into this woman that is taking up the responsibility of the position they find themselves in. Her husband just wanted to go to work, make a living, and provide for his family, and was confused and frustrated by the fact that the government wasn't allowing him to do that. I think she started to see the larger scope of it. Now, that doesn't mean she grabbed a sign and went out and protested, but she wrote those letters. You know, she allowed that documentary film crew into her house. She became the spokesperson for a couple that that otherwise couldn't speak. They didn't have a voice.
So how did you end up with an Aussie and a Brit in your Southern movie?
Yeah, well, Ruth came first. I was out here working on Midnight Special, and Francine Mazar, casting director, said, well, let's just start looking. Even though we didn't have financing or anything like that. And Ruth was the first person that came in. I wasn't familiar with her work. You know, literally, I'd shown up, and Francine handed me this headshot, and I was like, okay. And she walked in, and she was really nervous. And I get really nervous for actors in those situations because you just want them to be good and feel good and do a good job. And so we didn't talk at all. She just jumped into the scene, and she was Mildred, you know? Her back straightened, her mouth pursed, just like Mildred did. And you could immediately see that Ruth had been doing what I'd been doing, which is poring over this footage in this documentary. There was no question. It wasn't until after she got done with her scenes that she started to speak in an Irish accent. And I just, that's bizarre. But she left the room, and I turned to Sarah and Francine, and like, well, are we done? That's what it felt like. We saw a few other actresses, but she was Mildred. So that, you know, that was easy because, you know, I'd written this film with Richard and Mildred in mind, not actors. Right. So I needed to find people that looked like Richard and Mildred. I needed to find people that looked like Bernie Cohen. I needed to find people that looked like his mother and all of his friends. And so
we And I should correct while we're here that she's Irish, not British.
Yeah, she's Irish.
Irish people will kill me for having
She's
said
Irish
she's
and Ethiopian. She lives in London, though, so and she's done London stage work, so yeah. It's an easy confusion. But then I was working on Midnight Special with Joel, where he had to be a Texas state trooper. And I was watching kind of the mechanism that he put in place to work through that accent. And I wanted that because I had been listening to Richard so much and for so long. I didn't just want to cast somebody with a nice Southern accent because mm-hmm. what is that anyway? You know, people speak differently in Arkansas than they do in Georgia and than they do in Virginia, mm-hmm. especially when you add the period element. The coastal Virginia accent in the 60s was really strange. They say a boot instead of about. And I wanted an actor that was going to do the work and mm-hmm. go through the mechanics of not just imitating Richard's voice, but absorbing it. And I saw him do it on Midnight Special, and I knew with the amount of footage we had on Loving, he could do it. Mm-hmm. And he did.
And the Richard Cohen hire.
Bernie Cohen.
Bernie Cohen.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's fine.
Nick was not an obvious dramatic actor.
But see, it was an obvious choice to me. You know, I was making Midnight Special down in New Orleans, and I saw the Kroll Show come on, and I was like, yeah, that guy kind of looks like Bernie Cohen. Because again, all I'm thinking about is, who looks like these people? And I look him up, and if you check out the photo, I don't know if it's changed yet on his IMDb page, he's wearing like horn-rimmed glasses, and he looked exactly like Bernie Cohen. And so I just called him up. He came to see me in Austin. We had dinner, and like most comedians, he's extraordinarily intelligent. I believe he went to Georgetown. His dad went to Georgetown Law, which is where Bernie Cohen went and met Phil Hirschkopf. It just was weird. It was uncanny. And at the time, I hadn't watched The League, so I wasn't, you know, really affected by that. I'd watched The Kroll Show, which is insane and hilarious, but I just wasn't that affected by it. And he looked like Bernie Cohen. The choice was very easy, again, you know, and he showed up and did a great job. And if you
he was
look,
great. He's really great in the movie.
If you look at the documentary footage of Bernie Cohen and you look at what he does in the movie, it's uncanny. It really is, which is important to me.
So you are it sounds like you're a gut caster.
I think so.
Or anything else?
things just feel right, you know? And then once you break them down and start to analyze them, you can come up with a lot more reasons. But, you know, like take Ruth, for instance. I hadn't seen Mildred walking around in the other movies. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't mean there weren't a handful of actresses that could have come and done a good job with the role, but I just felt like there was a story to tell there of finding somebody, and we found Ruth, you know. Now, in the meantime, she went and made Preacher, and now that started to affect her trajectory in a positive way. But, you know, at the time, it just made sense to go find Mildred, you know.
Mm-hmm. So is this a hard shoot for you?
No. This was the best shoot I've ever had in my life. Mm. When Big Beach was talking about financing it, we were at a price that got us at about 35 days. But the original schedule I'd built with my AD was 40. And I really wanted 40 days, which is a really long shoot for a film like this. Mm. Like, there's a version of this film that you make, that I make, for $1.52 million. You scrap it together, you hope the period piece doesn't betray itself, and you shoot it in 3 weeks, you know?
A lot of close-ups.
I've done that, you know, on other films, not as a period piece, but I've rolled the dice, and luckily they've come up well for me, where, you know, there's no margin for error, there's no safety net. And I was tired of it, and this film deserved more, and we were able, with that 40 days and with the money that Big Beach put in, I mean, I was able to precisely direct this film. Now, that's not to say people will like it or it's any better than the others. What it means is the execution from script to screen, it was precise. It's exactly what I wanted it to do. And I knew, because of the way I wanted the camera to move, that it would take some time. I wanted there to be camera movement, but I didn't want it to be steady cam, you know, or handheld. There are a couple of handheld scenes that I think work appropriately when they come out of the Virginia State Court. But that's a unique situation. For most of it, I wanted it to be solid, locked off camera, because these people are trapped in the situation that they're in. But that doesn't mean I didn't want it to move with them. So automatically you're like, well, is that a crane? Is that dolly? And I was looking at the behind the scenes footage of No Country for Old Men, and they had this great dolly rig with an offset jib head with a remote head. And that's what we ended up doing for a lot of it. And the problem is, though, the actor's just going to walk from here to there, but we've got to set up dolly track and we've got to set up this head and everything else, and it's a bit of a dance that takes more time. So I knew I needed that time in those days, not just to make sure the lighting was accurate and that we had time to make the period piece elements really work, but also the camera movement. It was just going to take more time. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't mean the movie feels bigger or more produced. In fact, quite the opposite. But from a directing standpoint, it's precise.
So you don't want us to notice?
No.
Those choices. You just
camera, no, camera movement is, no. That's, you should never notice it, in my opinion. It should always be motivated by character movement. But also I did something that was a bit of a risk for me, because I'm such a advocate of you know, making sure all camera movement's motivated. I did something in this film where I motivated it through emotion, meaning, and this clip's online if you want to go look at it, when he proposes to her in this field, there's a shot of her where she realizes she's not just in this field down the road from her house, she's in the site of her new home, potentially. And there, she doesn't move, nothing happens, but you have an amazing actress like Ruth, who you just see the wheel spinning and this change comes over. Well, we accented that by, on that same, you know, dolly setup, just a slow pushing on her face. And I know, you know, there are probably a lot of filmmakers out there going like, it's a big deal, like you did a push-in, good job, great, congratulations. But for me, that's very unusual, because what you're doing is, there is a point of view for that movement, but it's directly connected to the character's emotions, but it's not being physically motivated by her. And I remember standing on set, and Adam Stone, my cinematographer who's worked with me on all five films, was like, I don't know if we can get away with this. This might be cheesy. And he's like, yeah, I think it's going to be good. And, but you know, those were all very calculated decisions and moments. You know, when she's on those phone calls, how do you make a phone call interesting? But the first one she has with Bernie Cohen, by the end of it, her world's in a different place, just like that in that field. And I just wanted to do that at the very end of the call, right when you know, she said, he tells her that the ACLU will pick up all of the expenses. Mm-hmm. You just do this slight move around her, and it's, she's not moving, but she is. Like, her whole world's shifting. And these are really simple things. I don't want people to notice them. I just want them to feel them.
Mm. So, in the precision of your shooting, do you know what you do at the end of the shoot? Do you just, does it all line up? Is cutting a very complicated process for you, or is it pretty straightforward?
Yeah, and I don't want to, you know, take credit away from Julie Monroe, who's been my editor since Mud, but I think she would even say, especially after Midnight Special, this movie just came together very quickly. You know, we ended up having a cut of it, and I had to leave to go take Midnight Special to Berlin and then go on a press tour for its release. And we just kept kind of saying, I don't know, it's pretty good. You know, like, I don't know what else we should do. Everybody always wants you to take a little bit of time out. But I'd written a really tight 96-page screenplay. So when we were sitting at 113 minutes, which we always knew would be longer than the 96 pages because of the amount of silence and air that I always put into things. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't like an unacceptable length, you know? And the movie felt like it carried you through it. Certainly other filmmakers would go in and take 15 minutes out. I'm not that filmmaker.
They would take the air out.
Yeah, they'd take air out, which, you know, probably there's some air that could come out. But but there's a tricky balance there, too. There's a lot of impact that happens in that air. Even when I was looking at and reviewing the marketing materials that Focus is putting together, which are really great, mm-hmm. they're ending a lot of the spots with Joel saying, "Tell the judge I love my wife." It's a great line. It, like I said, it's kind of the essence of the whole thing. But they had a few versions of the trailer that kind of, it just clipped the moment before he says it, mm-hmm. just truncated it a little bit, and it just takes takes the piss out of it. Mm-hmm. And you're like, just, instead of having five different shots back here of different characters, just take those out, just to buy one more beat, you know, maybe two more beats, 16 frames. And it'll make that line land better. And that's, I don't know. That's, the, but for your
it's
first
amazing
question.
How much a half a second changes everything.
It's huge.
It is huge.
It's huge, the cadence and how it affects people. And yes, after you've seen the film 100 times and you watch it again and again, you're like, maybe I could take a little bit of air out. But you have to think about the way the audience processes it for the first time. And you really do want those things to land. It's my approach.
Well, it's a movie about thought. I mean, it's not an action movie. It's not
the opposite.
Bing, 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 event. It really is about spending time lingering with this, as you say, through the seasons, through the years.
It's part of the punishment of the thing.
Yeah. You know,
the torture of the thing is through time. And also, to have to sit there, you know, there's the scene between Richard and the sheriff where Richard walks into the sheriff's office and he can't even look the sheriff in the eye. He knows he shouldn't look the sheriff in the eye, but you just get to hang on Joel giving this great performance of just sheer frustration and just completely being emasculated in this moment. And we just get to hang on him and look at him. And I find that scene to be as riveting as, you know, an action sequence.
Yeah. Well, it's emotional action. Which is your whole thing.
I guess, yeah, I guess.
But I mean, it really has been through your career so far. It feels like that's your signature.
That's the point of Midnight Special. You know, when the boy jumps out of that car and Mike Shannon turns around and calls his name out, he says one word, the boy's name, but that gets me every time. I mean, that it does. It takes me down to my knees. And who builds a film with a climax of a character's face? You know, I guess that's me. For better or worse.
You're secretly French.
The French really do like my films. I'll say that. I've had a lot of support over there.
So when you have the film, you finally get to show the film. Is that nerve-wracking, or are you at peace with where you're at when that happens?
In Cannes?
Yeah.
I was pretty at peace with it. Although with this one, I was ready to get it back to the States. Mm-hmm. I wanted America to see this film. And, you know, of course, so this is how your day goes on the premiere of a film in Cannes. You wake up, Everybody's excited. You put on a suit. You go and you do your photo call. Mm-hmm. And then you sit down and do a little interview with the French TV. And then you go to a press conference. Now, all the journalists have just watched it. But you have no clue of what they think about it. You've gotten maybe some tweets that your manager walks over and goes, "Hey, it's pretty good." Or in the case of Mud, like, "Oh, there was a technical glitch." And but you do the press conference. You try and speak honestly and clearly about the film. You're nervous. You go do a little bit more press, but then you take a break. You go home, back to your hotel room. You put on your tuxedo. You look at your phone. The first few reviews start to come out. And you can't help but calculate the rest of the evening based on those, you know? For Mud, I remember there was a bad review that came out. It was the first one that hit. And it just, it was terrible. And for Loving, the reviews were good, but they were also very much about me. Very much about Jeff Nichols as a filmmaker and the choices I made as a filmmaker. And I remember thinking, they aren't talking about the Lovings, you know? They aren't talking about how quiet the Lovings were. They're talking about how quiet my movies are. And as, on the one, and they're mostly saying it in a positive way. And as flattering as that is, you realize, oh, I'm in a place that is judging the filmmaker. That's what Cannes is wonderful for. That's why we love it. But at the same time, I wanted people to be talking about the Lovings. And I felt like if we could get it back to the United States, that conversation would shift. When I first started talking about kind of the marketing strategy with Focus and everything else, I was like, I don't really want this just to be a Jeff Nichols film. You know, I want Richard and Mildred to do the speaking for it, as they should, you know. We'll see how that turns out.
And have you seen it in America with a big audience? Because you were in Toronto, right?
Toronto. You know, so no, not yet, technically. But they've been doing a lot of small screenings around, and I've gotten the reactions of those, and they're in line with what I was hoping. You know,
screening it in the South be a big deal for you?
I can't wait. You know, I just think it's important, and I rarely say films are important, but I think it's important for people to know about this part of our history, especially as Southerners, and also to think about it in terms of a current context, you know, in terms of equality in general, marriage equality specifically, and race, you know. These people, the Lovings are great communicators in that sense. They may not be able to thread a sentence together for Richard Loving, but their story communicates very clearly, I think, how we need to be having this debate, how we need to be having these arguments and conversations that are desperately needed in our country. They're a great voice to put at the center of it.
So you're not of the world is already saved proclivity?
No. No.
I think it's pretty apparent in this election season that there's still a fight going on.
Yeah, and you know, unfortunately, it's not just the election. That just puts it on the front page every single day. But no, this country has some serious things we need to talk about. And how we talk about them is very important. You know, there was so much aggression in the country when we screened this film in May. In Cannes, the conversation was happening one way. The police shootings happened in Dallas and Baton Rouge, as well as these riots in Charlotte. The conversation we're having now, the aggression is still there, but the way the conversation's being handled, I think, has evolved. We have to get better at having the conversation. And some people just don't want to have the conversation at all. And that's not an option.
On both sides.
On both sides.
Sadly.
Well, it's going to be painful. Yeah. It's going to show sides of ourselves that we don't want to share with people. But we need to be honest and start talking about this stuff. And again, the Lovings are just they're an apolitical couple. They weren't trying to make a point. There's no agenda. There's no, you know, left-wing liberal agenda of pushing marriage equality down your throat with this film or these people. That wasn't what they were doing. They just loved each other, and it's a beautiful example of that. And maybe, just maybe, you know, some people will walk into the theater and experience the film and I don't know, open up their minds a little bit to the concept at the core of it, which honestly is libertarian. On the face of it, it's just like the government doesn't get to tell you what to do and who to love in your home. That's one thing that's just not, that's not what we get to do as a government or as a society. And so, you know, maybe the film helps with that conversation. Certainly, if you pay attention to the Lovings, they'll help with it.
Well, I think it's a world conversation, not even, I mean, the United States obviously has its specific issues, but it's definitely like the whole sense of how we all fit together on this planet that gets smaller every year.
Well, I heard some insane statistic the other day, and I'm going to misquote it, so you all should go fact check me, but that the prison population in France was like 70% Muslim, even though they make up 2 to 3% of the actual population. I mean,
which in our case is black.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, this is happening. This is happening other places.
Yeah. Well, fear is hard to get over.
Fear is one of the worst, you know, human instincts, unfortunately. It shows the worst part of ourselves.
Well, thank you for coming.
Hey, thanks for having me. Yeah, yeah.
Thank
you. Nice speaking with you.
And you.